Good morning, Church. Our track annual conference, in short, our Trinity annual conference, in short, track, has put together 5 W's of on track together for God's word, worship, welcome, witness, and wonder. The emphasis is on wonder for this year 2018, which will come to a close when the annual conference comes together. With that, TREK is encouraging every of their church with this common theme to be preached on Laity Sunday. So I find no greater joy than in sharing with you God's wonder of a new life in Christ. Today, being Laity Sunday, means the clergies are taking a mini break. The clergies means your pastors. So as we begin this service, would you please join me in our opening prayer? Lord God, as your word is delivered, open our ears, minds, and hearts to hear your voice. Receive your eternal wisdom and love. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. Exactly 2 Sundays ago, Pastor Lynette preached on how you can obtain salvation. She quoted from Romans chapter 10, verses 9 to 10. If you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. For today, as I bring God's word to you, just remember these 2 verses. It is that simple. But I'm going to take the opportunity to progress it a bit further, a little further. Upholding that declaration and challenging us onto greater faith. And above all, believing we are justified and saved. So for today's sermon, I'm going to take from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 to 14. It is rather lengthy, so I will not read, or I will not ask us to read all in one go, but instead we shall read the first 5 verses together. So let's read it together. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in the resurrection like his. This is the word of God. In those verses just read, notice the words baptized and baptism. During the time of Jesus and the apostles' ministries, baptism usually follows a close second after a convert professed their faith. And it's probably due to the intense persecutions that was then going on. Or it could be a calling by the Holy Spirit, or a pronouncement by an apostle, Or in the case of John the Baptist, he preached a baptism of repentance. Contrast this with your usual understanding of baptism, what I would call the rites of baptism. The application of water through the sprinkling of water or the immersion into the water. But in both instances, the infilling of the Holy Spirit is always there. The two are entirely distinct from each other. One is visible, the other is invisible. One is the human act that washes the body clean, whereas the other is the Holy Spirit in an act done in the soul. Let me borrow a quote from John Wesley about baptism. He said, "The new birth is represented by baptism, which is the beginning of a complete restoration to life." So with that understanding, the baptism that we normally understand, the rites of baptism, and the other one, which is the infilling of the Holy Spirit, that baptism will show to us three aspects of a believer. The believer being the Christian, the crucifixion of the Christian or the believer, and the consecration of the believer. When Paul stated in verses 1 and 2, he says, "What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase?" He says, by no means. Absolutely no. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? See, Paul wrote to a community in Rome that was divided over the degree to which the Old Testament law should continue to guide believers. Paul explores the problem of human sin, the solution provided in the cross, and the assurance of the glory that a living relationship with Christ provides. So here Paul, in a very rhetorical way, asking a question but answering it himself with an emphatic "by no means." Imagine a situation like this. Even a believer that says, "I like committing sins, I like committing crime, and my God, who is a forgiving God, will forgive them all. I sin, he forgives, he gets all the glory." We know that is almost pure nonsense. It's illogical. Or even in our Singapore context, what I call in our Singlish context, imagine a son or a daughter who is very wayward, committing all kinds of wrongdoings. And each time he or she commits those sins, the father says, "Never mind, lah, son. Try not to do it again next time, can?" And then the wayward child will say, "Ho se liao, no need to do homework, can ponten school. This kind of father I really want." Whereas an obedient child will say, "Allow, this kind of father, give me free, I also don't want." Yeah? So we need to see that the kind of relationship of that wayward child and the father cannot sustain. Back to the scripture verse, we're going to take that faith one step further. Here I'm addressing those who are baptized, or those who, what John Wesley says, the new birth, the beginning of a restoration to life. Essentially, it is for us believers, for us Christians, whether be it in total belief or having gone through the rites of baptism. But for those non-Christians among us, I will address them later. On Tuesday, I'm going to Japan with my wife, so I pick up this new Japanese word, chotto matte kudosai. Please wait a while, non-Christians, I'll address them later. So from the verses that we just read, when we say we are Christians, we identify with Christ. More specifically, our union with Christ gives us a new identity. Our union with Christ begins with the issuance of a death certificate. It sounded morbid, but it is true. Those who receive grace have died to sin. And a certificate of death is the believer's baptism. We don't think of baptism as marking a death in the way of a death certificate. But Paul says all of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, into his death. To say that we have been baptized into Christ means that we identify with his cause and his purpose. Baptism becomes a certificate of death of an old way of life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 to 2, I'll read them to you. Paul refers to the identity of the Israelites after they left Egypt. He says they were all under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and sea. When the Israelites followed God's directions, they were separated from Egypt, and they were separated onto Moses. From slavery into freedom, the Israelites' baptism was one of separation from a painful past to an identification with a better future. The past of slavery was dead, and the new life of freedom was then the present reality. But baptism not only signifies the end of a past life, it also identifies the believers with the one who died. In verse 4, he says, "We were buried with him." We were buried with Christ. We have been united with him in death. We identify, the person, the believer who has been baptized, identify with Christ. We come to the next few verses, which is verses 6 to 11. We know that our old self was crucified. Who is that old self? Who is that old self that Paul is referring to? What do we mean that the old self was crucified with him? In some Bible translation, and one of them is the King James Version, says the old man was crucified with him. The old self, or the old man, was crucified with him. It speaks of our humanity, identifying us by our relationship to our predecessor, the first Adam. That is the natural person we were before our union with Christ. Since the event of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden eating the apple, humankind suffered a spiritual and physical death, both in their bodies and in their relationship with God. You know about Adam and Eve taking the bite of the apple. For us, try not to ask a woman, was it a woman who asked a man to eat the apple? The woman will never ever admit. Or asking the man, did the woman ask you to eat? The man will always say, I just follow instructions. And to this day, that is the best answer for men. And then don't try to ask the snake. The snake don't talk. So in this fallen world, our just and gracious God will continue to sustain humankind for as long as they are living on earth. And why is this so? It is all about grace, about God's righteousness, and His desire for humankind to be reconciled back to Him. But the glory of our union with Christ is not fully explained when we speak of being united with Him in death. Jesus did not simply die. He rose again. And because He rose again, we are united with Him, not only in death, but also in His life. The death of the old self not only frees us from sin, the guilt of sin, it is also frees us from the control of sin, which is what Mark and his team sang. They are free from the slavery of fear. The control of sin is not the sin itself. Believe me, church, each and every one of us, we will continue to sin. How can the old self be not under the control of sin? The answer is simple. Dead people don't sin. You cannot make a dead person to commit wrong things. They can do nothing. We are dead. We are buried with Christ. We cannot commit any sin. No, we will continue to commit sin, but we are not under control of sin. The benefits of eternal security are not only in the future, but Christ, who grants us the temporal ability to live in Him while we are here. Most of the verses in verses 6 to 10 are directed towards giving us believers a sense of security in an insecure world. Issues of fear, failures, strained relationship, sickness are all prevalent in this insecure world. But eternal security should make us strive, sacrifice, and willing to live for Christ today, even when such commitment requires struggle, risk, and the sacrifice. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead now indwells and empowers us, the power of the Holy Spirit in us. When in our present condition, in our present physical condition, Paul wants us to understand a truth that applies to all believers, that we are spiritually united with the death of Christ. Certainly, we will yield to temptations, But that sin is a choice of our freedom and not a consequence of our slavery. I repeat, it is a choice of our freedom and not a consequence of our slavery. By Christ's resurrection and we living in Him, we are similarly dead to sin, alive in Christ. That is why we always say we carry our cross daily, relying on the Holy Spirit to guide and lead us in a process of sanctification. The work of grace is gradual, is progressive, and it relates to conflict with and a conflict over indwelling sin, the victory over indwelling sin. Let me read Romans chapter 8, 10 to 11. It says, "But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you." Look at verses 6 to 9. The key aspects of the passion narrative. When we say the passion narrative, we always identify with Jesus' crucifixion, His death, His burial, and His resurrection. And Paul are using these terms to indicate believers are united with Christ in every of these situations, crucified with Him, died with Him, also live with Him. United with Christ, we experience all the events of His passions, our shame and pain, the mockery, the betrayal, as He carried the cross for us onto Calvary. Our struggles, our fears, our failures, we die with Christ through His labored death up on the hill, on the cross. But sin, creating all that shame, struggles and darkness, did not have ultimate control over Christ and does not determine the fate of us, the fate of His people, because we are united with the One who rose from the dead and is seated with His Father. Jesus is our identity, our security, and our strength, because the old man, the old self, is dead, and Christ's life is now ours. So now, if you know that you are secured, you are loved in the grace of Christ, why would you bother to follow Christ? Why would you bother what God asked you to do? Paul answers these questions. For one who is truly motivated, one who is united with Christ, our union with Christ gives us a new calling. Let's look at the concluding verses in 12 to... Let me backtrack. 12 to 14. It says, "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer every part of yourself to Him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace." there is no such thing as a life redeemed without responsibility to the Redeemer. There's no such thing. We have been redeemed, we have a responsibility to the Redeemer. Paul gives those instructions in two ways. Negatively, he says, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness. In other words, don't give sin dominion over your life, and don't contribute it to others. You contributing to others, you influencing sin onto others. Whereas, positively, Paul is saying, offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Because believers are no longer their old self, under the enslavement of sin. Instead, present every part of yourself and every members of your body to God as instruments for righteousness. The incentives to live for God is that sin will have no dominion over us. By these instruments of righteousness, we are turning back the dominion of sin since the dawn of humankind. So the consecration of your body, the sinful body, buried it with Christ. Let the Holy Spirit sanctify your body in righteous living, in holy living. And let God take control of your body. So with wonderful power and grace of our union with Christ, we possess security beyond sin, the ability over sin, and the incentive to fight sin. Such grace is not a license to sin, but real power to overcome it. So far, you have been hearing me preach and teach. Now you're going to hear me from my own mouth of my life. So there is always a beginning. So I'll start from about 1992, about 93. Back then, I was staying in Bedok Reservoir Road, my wife and my two kids and my mother. Good career, children in primary school. Every Sunday, I'll drive them to church. For some strange reason, one of the four will always be a bit late, and I'll be like a speed demon coming down PIE, Adam Road, Farrer Road, Holland Road, North Buona Vista Road, and Dover Road. But we were not worshiping here. Remember, this is about early 90s, 92, 93. We were worshiping at the primary school hall. They worshiped there, not me. My place of worship, coffee shop across the street. You know, the Dover flats across, which is now uninhabited. There were two coffee shops, a wet market, and a small little garden. I spend my time reading the newspaper. I love to read fiction. At times, I'll walk the dog in the garden. That's how I spend my 2 or 2.5 hours. Whereas the family, the children were in the Sunday school, my wife be sitting somewhere in the first three pews. When I'm in a good mood, most of the time maybe not so good, eh? When I'm in a good mood, after my coffee and my reading, coming back to church to pick them up, I will help. Seriously, huh? I will help to stack up the chairs, roll up the carpet. Even a non-believer because they need help. We need this word called volunteers. It was not in my vocabulary then, but I did help when I'm in a good mood. But when I'm in a bad mood, when I came over to the church compound to pick up my wife and my children, somehow, at times, they will be late. And try to do this, hornet in the church. It's taboo. You don't do that. But Alan Ang did that, not once, but many times. Well, that was me then. And then one fine day, one person says, and this person I need to identify now. She doesn't know it, but now she's going to hear it from the horse's mouth. Sister Po Kim. Yeah, she don't know. She's not aware. And you know the musical person in her? Brother Alan, don't worry. Just sit down, listen to the music. Don't worry about the sermon. And I know why, because when you talk about 1 Kings, 2 Kings, Chronicles, it means nothing. Say, Brother Alan, just sit down, listen to the music, enjoy the music. That's what I did. I sit somewhere in a back pew, right at the back. For some reason, there appears to be some glue stuck on the pew, and I was stuck there for weeks and months and years. I was there. So I came to church, and I grew. That was the time when I'm saying I'm being baptized. I'm being restored to a new life in Christ. While that was going on, children in Sunday school, my wife worshiping with friends over here, she told the children, and later on she told me, we will not get baptized until Dad is ready. And Dad was ready in the year 2000. The whole family was baptized. We went through a baptism of immersion. But lo and behold, after the baptism, we have the church camp. And the first order of duty is, or was, you're the group leader for church camp. Know nothing about Christ, nothing. Group leader. A bit of suffering. But I went on to help in Alpha. Wife and I, we took disciple 1, 2, 3, 4. And for those who have been through, each disciple course takes about 9 months. So that took us a good 4 years. And it really helps in learning the Word of God. And usher, serving God, usher, everywhere. And I have been in LCC since the year 2001, except for the 2.5 years when I was overseas. Until today, I'm serving in LCC. God touched us. God needs us, not that He needs us, He wants us to serve Him in whatever capacity. So listen out, people, believers. God needs you. No ministry is lesser than the other. But to top it all up, while this was then going on in my life, personally, my greatest joy is my mother. In her 80s, she was near blind. She can only see a silhouette of a person. But the aura of the Holy Spirit was so strong in our family, my mother, in her 80s, accepted Christ and was baptized. That, to me, is a real turning point. And when she was called home to the Lord, of course I cried, but I says, Lord, thank you. Take her home. She is yours. Growing up in church, I went on to do some evening classes. I did the minimum classes, evening classes in TTC. In 1 year, I completed the minimum qualification to be a local preacher. So here I am, the minimally qualified local preacher. Many of my friends here says, Alan, why don't you continue to go and do TTC and be a pastor? And I always tell them, my runway is short. By the time the Methodist Church in Singapore will retire me before I even complete the course. But that's God's way of doing things. But I prayed about it, and at the end, I feel till today that that is the way God wants me to serve Him. So friends, just now when I said chotomate kudosai, I did not forget you non-Christians. Non-Christians, believers, bring it back home. Share it with family members. Share it with those who are non-Christians about the gift, the grace of God. Use my testimony if you need to. 6.5 years as an ordained driver, but a non-believer. So I leave you with two things. Be encouraged and trust God. Believe in the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you and thank you.